Suresh Prabhu, ladies and gentlemen, we start this evening's function, and on behalf of Ananta, I have been a very warm welcome. Ambassador Surinder Kumar is a machine, the way he works. You know, a few years ago, I read his autobiography and immediately rang him up. I said, you know, it's a great book. We started with a chapter, The Birth of an Ambassador, and ended with a very interesting chapter on which some people can have different views, but it reflected many realities. Since then, as I find from the book, he has edited or written 5 more books, total of 6, and for all we know, 2 are on the way. Well, we're very fortunate to have Shri Suresh Prabhu with us. And for us at Ananta Aspen, it's a special privilege because he has been a part of our endeavors. We have been together in different dialogues and discussions in Delhi, Washington, Tokyo, if you remember, and Singapore and other places. And, the one in Tokyo where some decisions were taken at midnight when we got the new Indian embassy building open to see. It was just well, very warm welcome to you back. We call this homecoming, aapka yaana. Well, this book, which has just come out, gives you a recipe for leapfrogging in the 21st century. He has managed to collect 24 people to contribute, all iconic. And over 10 of them are present here, and 9 will be speaking. So you will hear them. You have different viewpoints. It's a very interesting book. Lord Meghnad Desai speaks of equality of women and of all being together. Sonal wants that the rulers should be the servants of the janta. Shashi, who emphasizes on young India. Surinder Kumar, in fact, in his title, Democracy and Dissent and Inclusiveness, covers everything. Money, of course, Panchayati Raj. And my friend H.K. Dua laments that the judiciary and the legislature have declined, and there is need to bring them back. Well, each one will speak for themselves, and I will now request Ambassador Surinder Kumar to give us an introduction. Over to you.
Thank you. Normally, I don't use paper, but today I will, because I might forget some names and they might complain later. Honorable Minister of Railway, Sri Suresh Prabhu, Ambassador Lamba, Chairman Ananta Aspen Center, esteemed contributors of the book who are on the dais, who are in the hall, and who couldn't make it. Friends from diplomatic corps, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for coming. Securing national borders, ensuring political stability, maintaining friendly and productive relations with the world outside, putting the nation on the path of economic, social, educational, scientific, technological, innovative advancement, and meeting basic needs of shelter, health, hygiene, hunger of millions of its people, and bringing about positive change in their lives has always been a challenge for the government of the day. More so in today's globalized and interconnected world, exploding with aspirations and characterized by unprecedented transformational technologies. Taking an objective and dispassionate and holistic view, one can legitimately claim that India has come a long, long way since 1947. We should be proud of what we have achieved, though we can always argue whether we couldn't have done better. But we must not forget that we still have miles and miles to go. The largest number of poor, the largest number illiterate, and the largest number of malnutrition children still live in India. The other day, I saw some moving pictures of children in drought-hit Bundelkhand, who had only a chapati and a pinch of salt to stay alive. For them, life and death were separated by a dry chapati and a pinch of salt. Notwithstanding this, India is on the move. All economic indicators suggest that. The World Bank and the IMF say so. We are on the right path. If the grand vision of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, Make in India, Digital India, Startup India, Smart Cities, Bullet Trains, Industrial Corridors, Solar, Other Renewable Sources of Energy, Swachh Bharat, etc., succeed, India will be transformed beyond recognition. Prime Minister has aroused such huge expectations, he can't afford to fail. He will have to ensure that his concept of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, and Chalein Saath Saath don't remain mere slogans, but become a reality on the ground. So for India's sake, let's hope that he succeeds in his endeavors. The book offers a bouquet of 23 articles by some of the brightest brains sharing their perspectives about what will leapfrog India 21st century. No, I am not including myself in that category. These are as diverse as India itself. As Dr. Shashi Tharoor will say, it is like a thali offering 24 dishes, each different and distinct, but making a wholesome meal. Dr. Sampitra, Dr. Narayan Murthy, and Dr. Professor M.G.K. Menon have stressed the role of the innovation, digital connectivity in communication. Professor Deepak Jain, Professor Ralph Nicholas, and Dr. Vishakha Desai have underlined the significance of education. Dr. M.S. Swaminathan deals with nutritional footprint, while Arun Mayra and Kalyani Shankarji talk about corruption unsparingly. Bikram Mehta, Kiran Karnik, and Sunil Munjal. Expectedly demand more economic reforms and ease of doing business. Jatin Babu and Sonalji raise the issue of moral and ethical values. I am not referring to the contribution of those who are present. They will tell you more about their own contributions. Kindly note, the buck for these articles doesn't stop with Barkhadat, nor with me. They stop with each contributor. If you like their pieces, thank me profusely. But if you don't, please take their phone numbers and email ID from me and do some plain speaking with them directly. To the extent book makes you think, it triggers off some serious debate and discussion about how India can move forward, my purpose would have been served. Let me do some thanksgiving. First, my most sincere thanks to the Honorable Minister for doing us honor. Sir, I still have fond memory of our visit to Kellogg School of Management at 9 p.m. a decade back, where Professor Deepak Jain, who is contributed to this book, had served us some cucumber sandwich and a lot of food for thought. I wish all your initiative, which you had talked about India Today Conclave, succeed. Just a thought. Why not have literary festivals on the wheels? Just imagine a compartment full of writer, poet, and media enjoying literary fest on Rajdhani Express from Delhi to Mumbai. You can kill so many birds with one stone. My most sincere thanks to the contributors, without whose contribution there won't be this book. I must thank my senior colleague, Ambassador S.K. Lamba, who has been a special envoy of the Prime Minister of ages. He has a keen eye for details. After a farewell dinner for him by Benazir Bhutto, he sent a long dispatch, not only telling about things which are normally top secret, but also telling us the number of diamond rings that Benazir Bhutto was wearing, in the color of her dupatta. Kiran Pasricha, I have seen her for years. She's looking younger. You know, where did Shah Rukh Khan get that name of his love interest in film Dar? He uttered Kiran after meeting Kiran Pasricha in New York. Must thank Harshit Sehgal for all the meticulous planning and execution. Lastly, as is customary, I must thank my publisher and his entire team. After all, he has brought out this book. He has already got some kudos for his production qualities. But to be honest, the relationship between a writer, editor, and his publisher sometimes becomes like a case of marital rape. But I don't know how to establish the facts. If Soviet had his way, quite a few contributors whose name figure on the front page won't be part of this book. And if his internal editing team had used their long seizures as they wanted, many articles won't read as they do. I have valiantly fought to save the sanctity of the article submitted by my friend. And succeeded to a great extent saving their original texture and flavor. Nonetheless, I thank you, Soviet. One last appeal. My appeal is to Mr. Kanhaiya Kumar. Please add another slogan, Azadi from the loot of publishers. Let all the writers of the world unite. Let all the writers of the world unite. We have nothing to lose except our royalties. As I have repeatedly mentioned to all the contributors that they have only 180 seconds, each one of you. I think the charming lady will show yellow card, which means 2.5 minutes, red card means 3 minutes, your time is up. It's 3 times more than what you get here. Arnav Goswami's program in times now. He interrupts you, we won't interrupt you, so good luck to you. Thank you very much.
So good evening, friends. Let me congratulate as well as thank Ambassador Surendra Kumar for bringing out this book at a very right time. Because in any case, we are leapfrogging. So now how to leapfrog further is something we could understand from this book. I also must thank him for keeping his humor alive after serving in the government for so many years. So that's a great achievement, so congratulations.
Thank you.
As we can see, wherever you go, and this is what we experience whenever you travel, when you read something which appears outside of India, journals, television, any media, you have any discussion with people anywhere in the world, everybody is saying that India is a great success story. India is a story which now needs to be revisited, and India is really on the rise. So we'll definitely are progressing, and we'll progress even faster as we see two issues resolved in the country. One is something to do with the global headwinds which are hitting India, not only India, but probably all of the countries in the world. We always felt till 2008, that the only way the global economy is going to rise is in one direction. Because there has been unprecedented growth of global economy in the previous 3 decades. So this is unprecedented any time in the global history. Of course, there are some eminent economists. I should not venture into saying something which is in his domain. But, and suddenly, it was like a reality check, 2008 happened. And since then, most of the countries in the world are affected by this global headwinds. The largest economy, US, second largest economy, China, third, Japan, and all others. Probably, we are the only country which are not as badly affected. And if we can grow at this rate, when there are such global strong headwinds, one could imagine what would have happened if there was a tailwinds, which happened till 2008. And therefore, this is one factor which is not realizing India's full potential of growth. The second one is a legacy issue. We have actually seen the banking system, and I was talking to anybody, they said the corporate balance sheet is something which is cause of concern. If you want growth in economy, it can be investment led, So if you want investments, obviously the investments come from household, it must come from corporates. And eventually the household investment also will be channelized through an intermediary role of banking system or through the capital markets, but eventually will go into the corporates, which will actually make investment into acquisition of fixed assets. So therefore, that again is a big challenge. Corporate balance sheets are stressed, and this has been identified, and that is something which is a legacy issue. But despite these two, if you can grow at 7.5% and continue to grow at this rate, I am sure we'll really do very well in the years to come when the global situation will improve, the legacy issues will get addressed as we are doing now, and then we can see the true potential of India's growth happening. The issue is, when we grow, could we just grow only on economic terms? That's an issue. Could we just gauge our success in terms of GDP growth alone? Or should we look at the holistic way of growing as a society, not just as economy, as a nation, not just as state? And if you want to do all this, then obviously we must look at much broader canvas and must look at many more issues than just economic growth. And that's why I'm very impressed that you have come out with a book which does not just talk about growth in GDP alone. It does not talk about the conventional parameters by which we'll actually judge the progress of a society, but go beyond it and talk about so many things that really have gone into this book, whether it's art and culture, to science and technology, going into issues related to environment, and many others. And that is what is extremely important strategy, that we must grow at a very good rate, but just not grow only in a haphazard manner or only in a particular sector, but how do you grow holistically? And we have seen it in many other countries. When the growth came in, it also reflected, and this is not just now, it has been also the history, which of course, again, my good friend Shashi Tharoor is there, so I should not venture into that. But when we talk about it, we have seen that a society growing got reflected into growth of culture, growth of science. So this is not just growth that happens only in one aspect. So now, if we do not focus on all the aspects together, it may not really realize the true potential of India. I was just talking yesterday, coincidentally, in Goa, there was a very big seminar on India's emergence as a power. And I was saying that country like China were nowhere in the scene in terms of Olympics, because they deliberately were not participating in Olympics. US was obviously winning all the medals, and there is probably a correlation that economic growth, and therefore the largest economy, so they were also getting all this. China started growing economically, also grown it, they also started getting medals. So you can, the reflection of your economic growth also gets reflected into other sectors, but did not happen necessarily unless you have strategy in place. So we could actually just grow and ignore many other aspects, and therefore we really need to look at it. One good example is one of the largest economic as well as strong military bloc did not focus on all aspects of development of that country, and therefore it is disintegrated. So therefore I think holistic development is something which will be really important, and that's why I'm very impressed with this book that you really had talked about. We have seen some countries like China, for example, their economic growth has been phenomenal, now $10 trillion almost. And despite that, now China is struggling to find out how to repair the damage it caused during this growth to their natural capital. So now it's like marrying in haste and repenting in leisure. So rather than that, could we not think about not marrying in haste, marrying at leisure, and then try to put all the things into place is something which would be a good strategy. And I think that's why we really need to find out how could we work on each of these issues together? Sorry, did I make sense? So the point is, China is a great example. US is another example. There's so many things happened at the same time. Development of scientific institute, development of educational institute, development of sports, and many other things along with the growth of economy. But I'm not still saying that there is any one single perfect model which wants to be emulated. We have to develop our own model. We have so many ideas, so many things. So therefore, this book is very timely. At a time when our government is precisely doing all this, as you yourself pointed out, and therefore, all our prime minister's program, whether it's Make in India, is actually addressing the issue of how to correct the imbalance into the GDP profile of India. We cannot just depend on services alone at the expense of manufacturing or agriculture. So therefore, Make in India makes sense to create new jobs, to create a manufacturing base on which services will grow anyway, because manufacturing will need services like insurance for tourism, for the banking and others. So therefore, the service will get picked up. The manufacturing also would mean that we'll create new demands for products from farm. Therefore, whether it's a natural fiber industry, which will grow like growing cotton will be demanded. Food processing will create demand. So this is one thing which is actually doing it. Digital India, another very interesting program of the government. And I know many of you must have heard when the Cisco CEO was here. And he said in the next 10 years, 85% of the companies who are not digitally compliant will be just vanish. So just imagine, we have a great advantage, maybe a late started advantage. And I think I must congratulate and thank some of my friends who did not bring in as much development as would have been there. So now we can actually leapfrog into that in a big way. And also start working in a manner that we do not get locked into a system. This is a very interesting idea, because digital India would mean that we'll have a new model of development based on the new digital technology, which will be the order of the day. And therefore, this is something which is a program of the Prime Minister. Whether we should keep India clean or not, it is not a government program, it's a societal program. But this is something which is led by the Prime Minister, and we are none other than Mr. Shashi Tharoor as a brand ambassador. So therefore, it has to succeed. She's also the ambassador, but I know. Of course, she's an ambassador for many things. No, in a sense, India's ambassador, the cultural ambassador.
I'm self-appointed ambassador for culture, that's another matter.
But Mr. Shashi Tharoor, of course. And therefore, what point I'm saying is, many of these programs, whether Skilling India program and others, and I'm not saying that this is a monopoly, this is a program not just of government of India, it's a program of India. So I always say that Make in India is not Make in India, it is making of tomorrow's India. And therefore, to make that, we really need the participation, support of everybody. And therefore, this book is something which is not a political party manifesto, which we keep writing. And I don't know how many of us read it, including the people who actually make it, so we don't make it. And therefore, this particular thing is like a blueprint for India's holistic development. Leapfrogging India, not just in economic terms, but actually leapfrogging India into a new type of thinking, new type of culture, new type of society, which will enable us to actually be the leader in many areas that we are capable of and we have a potential of. So I think we should try to look at it. So I must congratulate Mr. Surendra Kumar, Ambassador Surendra Kumar. He has brought in so many brightest minds together to make this book possible. I'm very happy that we have very distinguished colleagues of mine who are senior leaders like Mr. Manishankara here. So I should not be speaking too much when he's here around. And I should really look forward to listening to many of them, because in Parliament, we would like to listen, but sometimes they don't allow us to speak. So I think we'll really look forward to listening to him, and we'd like to take forward the ideas how to create a society which is bipartisan, which is going to have a program which can be pliable as a government program, not just because the government in office at that time, but as programs which government implements as agents of society in which everybody participates, so that this program becomes a change agent for making tomorrow's India. So thank you very much, and congratulations to you.
Thank you for your remarks, and that sets the tone for the discussion. I will now request Dr. Sonal Mansingh. She's next. Now 3 minutes each, says the program.
Darling, don't worry. Being a dancer and discipline is ingrained in me. I'm not a political leader, thank you.
Not yet.
Hello. Anyway, namaskar to everyone and all the guests on the dais, and congratulations to Surendra Kumarji. I think he's one of the rarities in bureaucratic circles who has real interest in culture. And I'll make it very short. When I wrote this short article for What Will Leapfrog India, I would like to translate it into Sanskrit, because this is one of my passions, to understand any concept of or idea. First, I think in Hindi or my mother tongue Gujarati or Sanskrit. Then I get the correct meaning and definition, and the dhwani, as we call the nuance. And then I translate it again into English. So leapfrog for me is utplavan. Utplavan is a huge leap, but a leap upwards and onwards. And ut, like in utsav, is also indicative of celebration. It's full of energy. Right. I don't know what I wrote at that time, but since then, I think a lot of ideas have flown in my head, so I'm just going to share a few, Surendraji, because people can read the article in any case. Rulers as servants of people, I think somebody mentioned.
Start the clock again.
Yes.
Kaal is eternal. Time is eternal. Flows. So, rulers are servants of people. That was, I think, one of the ideas that I... Because in 1975, way back, that was before the emergency was declared, and Sathe, V.P. Sathe was the first MP, a Lok Sabha MP, and I had come back after my deadly accident in Germany, all ready to dance. My spine had broken. So one of my first performances was for MPs, members of parliament, in Mavlankar Hall, and then members of parliament those days were very interested in culture. So Indira Gandhi also was present, and there V.P. Sathe floated the idea that Sonal should give a workshop to members of parliament. And I said, sure. Dance, music, hastamudras, abhinaya. In any case, they use hastamudras, but without knowing what they're doing. They use a lot of their eyes and gestures without knowing how they should be used. But newspapers picked it up and made a big hoo-ha about it. But I said, read the bottom line, read the underpinning. Swara laya, sur aur taal, har cheez jeevan mein sur taal mein chale, to sahi rehta hai. Jab besurapan betalapan aata hai, hamare vicharon mein, hamari jeevan shaili mein, karya kaal mein, to gadbad ho jati hai. This was the point that I wanted to share with you. Swachha swastha Bharat. It was mentioned that Shashi and I and whatever, so Swachha is okay, we know. I do place importance on the word Swastha, and the real meaning again, Sva me sthita hona is Swastha. To be with yourself, to be absolutely tranquil and centered, and when you are centered, the world around you, the environment around you also becomes centered. So that for me is Swachha. Swastha Bharat, Shreshtha Bharat, for which I'm using my whatever talents I have. I want to also say that constant flow of ideas and energy, what Mr. Prabhu just now said, you know, there were a lot of things that he said. Constant flow of ideas, energy, and action, that's the only way to leapfrog. There can be no damming. You cannot build dams around ideas and concepts and actions just because you don't agree or it doesn't suit you. And this is what my vidha, dance, teaches me, that pour your energy, pour your ideas, pour yourself, not only for your own good, but for the good of all. So I thought that a slogan I will give today, why only Prime Minister Modi? I think we can all do that, no? We can all contribute. My slogan is, wake up India. Thank you.
Thank you, and that brings us to Shri Mani Shankaraya.
We became independent in 1947 as a nation.
but I don't think our people have received freedom. In this situation, it seems to me to underline the two most relevant facts of current Indian existence, that in terms of growth of GDP, we have emerged this year as the fastest growing large economy in the world. We have also emerged this year as at position 132 of the UN Human Development Index. There is growth for some, and there is injustice for most. And the only way in which we can translate democracy into development is to do it in the way in which we've translated democracy into development for about 200 to 300 million Indians, which is to empower them. There is a middle class in India that has got empowered and has therefore succeeded in securing for itself, from the state, but securing for itself, the best education at the lowest prices in the world, which is why you wouldn't have the internet without the IITs, which is how we have entrepreneurs who are world-renowned as a result of our management schools and our business schools. You cannot run the national health system in Britain without the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And Obamacare wouldn't take place if there weren't lots and lots of Indian doctors to serve them. So in these circumstances, it is clear that it is because the aristocracy, the landed aristocracy, was abolished between 1948 and 1949 and replaced with a middle class democracy, that this middle class democracy has been able to access its entitlements and has reached this point of enrichment. But as far as about 900 million Indians are concerned, they have not been empowered, and therefore they do not secure their entitlements. And without empowerment, there can be no entitlements. And without the two of them, there can be no enrichment. And the only way forward is to empower the people at the grassroots in exactly the same way as we have empowered the middle class of India, which is to give them the benefits of democracy. For that, we have to convert representative democracy in Delhi and in the state assemblies, not just convert, I meant supplement representative democracy in Delhi and in the state capitals by participative democracy at the grassroots. We've got the institutions. We have 2.5 lakh of these locally elected bodies. To them, we have elected 3.2 million or 32 lakh representatives, of whom 14 to 15 lakh are women. And we're just not utilizing them because we are not transmitting what we have at the center in terms of resources into the hands of these elected representatives. And I'm sorry Mr. Suresh Prabhu is gone, because I wanted to thank him for having reduced the budget of the Ministry of Panchayat Raj from 6,000 rupees to 100 crore rupees. 6,000 crore rupees to 100 crore rupees is very kind of him. He has also slashed everything that is available in the social sectors, in education, in health, in MGNREGA. Everything is being reduced, and somehow make in India seems to be to make the rich in India richer rather than to include the poor of India in our development process. It is a plea against that, a constructive plea, I hope, that I have placed before the readers in terms of arguing why, even though we've had Panchayat Raj for over 20 years, it is absolutely essential that we actually empower these bodies. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments on Panchayat Raj, which we had anticipated, and now Dr. Shashi Tharoor.
Thank you, Ambassador Lamba and Surendra, for putting this book together. Surendra asked us to talk only about the essays that we've contributed, so mine was about young leadership and the future of India, prompted by, amongst other things, the 2014 election, where every one of us found we had about an average of 90,000 new first-time voters. The number of young people entering into the political process as voters, in turn, needs to translate itself into the kind of participation in the political process that sadly we don't see enough of. In fact, I think The Economist in 2013 did a study showing that India held the world record by far for the largest gap between the average age of the population and the average age of the cabinet. The average age of the population at that time was 27 and the average age of the cabinet was 65. We then went through the final cabinet reshuffle of the UPA government and the gap widened and we broke our own record with the induction of our last three ministers. So that has been the traditional culture of India. We respect age and so we should, but we sadly don't open enough doors for those who are young enough to bring new blood and new ideas into the system. In my article, I give a few numbers, the potential demographic advantage that we could have. And I recall on my first sort of parliamentary party meeting as a newly elected MP back in 2009, our then 78-year-old Prime Minister Manmohan Singh telling us all that we must learn to respect the impatience of the young. And I think he was right. It was actually an extremely good message because we have a young, impatient, aspirational generation of under 35s who are 65% of India's population, 50.1% under 25. So there's no question that they are much more attuned to what's going on around the globe, much more anxious to have more opportunity. They already have, thanks to the liberalization process started in 1991, they have more opportunities than their forebears did, than those of us on the podium had when we were their age, but they want more, and of course, they do want action, not slogans. This is not a political statement, but it's true. They want results, not bromides. And so we have no shortage of slogans, but we do need to see the ending of the significant gap between the political process and the participation in it of India's brightest young sons and daughters. And the enthusiasm that was seen during the nationalist movement by a lot of young people needs to be recaptured. I think it's beginning to happen. Interestingly enough, one is seeing more and more educated young people beginning to think the previously unthinkable and contemplate a political career. And of course, keeping them away from politics, or they're choosing to keep away from politics, will only restrict the progress and growth of India in the 21st century. My card is up, so let me just end less than halfway through my essay by just quoting from a letter that I wrote to young professionals in my constituency, urging them to get involved in politics. And if I may read from that letter, politics is not merely about elections every few years. It is about determining the choices your country makes, which intimately affect your daily lives wherever you live and work. Our government is doing a great deal that young people can't afford to be indifferent to. Decisions are being taken on life and death issues about yourself and your families. And if you are not involved in the process that arrives at those decisions, it simply means that you do not care. Vital decisions that will affect your professional opportunities, the investment climate in our country, the way in which revenues are raised and spent, and the policies that will affect your own advancement are being formulated and taken in various forums by local bodies, the state legislatures, and at the national level through Parliament. It's the political process that establishes these institutions and determines their composition. Please join it. And I think this is something which cuts across all political lines. We all have an interest in seeing more young people register to vote, show up to vote, engage with the process of formulating positions, supporting candidates, and eventually playing a part in the electoral process themselves, whether it's at the local level, the village panchayats that Mani spoke about, city councils, and eventually, of course, state assemblies in the parliament, but also in the very, very many processes between elections to these bodies, which help determine the future of this country. And I think really we do need to make way more and more for the young to assume their rightful place in this.
Thank you, Sati. Much has been said about leapfrogging. Frankly speaking, leapfrog also leaps in jerky moments. So I can see with best of intentions, it's going to be a very jerky move forward by India. I'm optimist nevertheless. But my worry is something else. Optimism has to be based on realities. We got a very good constitution, believing in democracy, believing in plural democracy, believing in secularism, tolerance of dissent. The values enshrined in the constitution are being thrown overboard over a period of time, particularly now. Mani spoke about education and health budget. It's a serious, serious development. When education is the one thing that can take India forward in a short time at a speed in the 21st century when we want to be major economic, political, nuclear power of the 21st century. That's a settled aim. There is no difference of opinion among political parties on that. But can we do, when we are harming the education in university after university, in institution after universities, if Anil Kakodkar has to resign from the IIT selection board, which was to select the directors, so you can imagine the state of education. Universities are being targeted for capturing. This is the target number one, this is the target number two. One reads in the newspapers how they are being, as an object of capturing rather than object of service to society. No nation has made progress on the basis of ignorance, and we are shunning that opportunity. Schools in the villages are in bad shape. If the schools are there, the teachers aren't there. If the teachers are there, they're not teaching there. Some of these proxy teaching is going on in village after village. In many states, one can verify. IITs, 40% vacancies of the IITs are there. And if they are attending, then faculties are being marked. This has been captured or not captured. Health sector also, as Mani pointed out rightly, is abysmal. Somewhere down on the world human index, both health and education, we are far below. What about drinking water? Villages after villages, they don't have drinking water, and they have to share the water from the pond with the animals, like that kind of thing. So we are somewhere, we are getting derailed. Institutions with parliament, judiciary, executive. Parliament is not functioning well, as everybody knows. And they are all to blame. There is a red flag for me, but that's not my fault, actually. That is the fault of Ambassador Surendra Kumar. Yesterday, he sent a notice. He's a habit of sending too many notices. And yesterday, he sent a notice that you will get 180 seconds. So it reminded me of Twitter. There the question of space is involved, 144 letters. So he's in timescape, he says 180 seconds. No, I don't know how many stopwatches he has. I think stopwatch is over there when shows that red flag. The point I'm making is, essentially, I'll wind up, ladies. The ladies at the back who are showing the red flag. Now, the point I'm making is we have to respect the institution and the constitutional values which are tolerant, we should not create tensions which will stop our leapfrogging attempt in the 21st century. A lot of intolerance to dissent without realizing dissent is the salt of democracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me take up something that Manishankar Iyer said, which is very, very cogent, and as other speakers have pointed out, that India, even despite 25 years of growth since 1991, we didn't have very much growth before, but I won't go into that, has not really achieved any high status in human development. That's not because of fact that we are third world, because lots of third world countries, including Bangladesh, have done better than us. Secondly, I think he also very quite rightly said that in the first 40 years, maybe 50 years after independence, the middle classes had a great time. They're still having a great time. And he mentioned the cheap education, cheap higher education that we have. And I've in the UK, I have participated in a movement which some people think is deeply reactionary, which is to make people pay proper price for higher education. I can see why primary and secondary education should be free, but I see absolutely no reason why higher education should be free or even cheap. I think, you know, if we had more universities which charge proper fees, we would have better universities. But that's another story. There are some various urgent reforms I've said in my article, some of which have been implemented, but I don't want to dwell on that. My main concern is that we have really a deep conflict between a great ancient culture and religion, which we all value, and a society in the same context, which is deeply hierarchical and very unequal. And our habits of thinking, our culture, is inegalitarian. Surendra Kumar wrote a brilliant article in Asian Age a while ago, which I may remind him, in which he said, how is the Foreign Service a sort of grandee? One of the ambassadors asked him, he says, I'm about to meet these three young recruits of IFS, but I don't know their caste. I don't know how to behave towards them. This is IFS. This is the cream of the cream, I'm told. You know, it was my dream to be IFS. But, you know, there we are. So I think we have deeply rooted hierarchical habits and what I'd call social equality. Equality of rank, not of income, but of rank. When my cleaning lady comes once a week to my house, I can't afford more than that, I make her a cup of tea. First thing I do is make her a cup of tea. And then she goes, does it, and when she leaves, I treat her as an individual, not below me, not above me, but and she behaves to me just like one-to-one. We don't have that. And it doesn't look like we are going to achieve that. No matter how much we say about Ambedkar, you know, we're not going to achieve that. Secondly, and more deeply than anything else, women's position. And since my red card is up, I mean, this is hardly not an obvious fact that women's position in India is appallingly bad. And unless we can do something drastic about that, half of India's population, sadly less than exactly half of India's population, will not achieve the fruits of development that the rest of them do. Thank you.
I'm so sorry for not being part of the panel in time, because there was another program where I was held up with Mr. Naidu. And it's important to discuss that program as well, because Delhi, after 33 years, has changed its bylaws to make it convenient and ease of doing business. Several forms, like you would apply to Airport Authority, Army Land, so on and so forth, has been reduced from 36 to 9, and single window clearance. So that is something good for the citizens of Delhi. And I'm saying so because for past 1 year, when we didn't have a government in Delhi, the legislative body was non-existent. It was at that time we undertook this process. And we completed it and we have implemented it. So Achhe Din, more or less, from the central government side are there. And it is in this context that green building laws, right to respond, of course, the green building bylaws, et cetera, are all on board and successfully implemented single window clearance. Alongside this, the STP from a relatively largish hotel called Vasant Continental is supplying their wastewater for the maintenance of parks in Munirka and Munirka Vihar. Vasant Vihar already got one STP, so that's the other model when it comes to treating the water. Why I started from this was to show that the environment solution, the climate change that we all keep hearing, discussing, talking, these are small changes which are relevant for bringing in the requisite bigger change to harvest the fruits of green energy and renewable energy and arrest the climate change in small ways. And India is on the right path with the traditional knowledge and conservative skills and conserving the environment. And if you look at it from the perspective internationally, so the solar alliance that we have successfully set up and the office is going to be very close to Delhi, that's Gurgaon, is one such certification if at all somebody needs how successful the foreign policy has been. And why I say so, in the write-up also I started with the lines that if 19th century was the time when somebody had to be in UK, Britain or England, to bear the fruits of development. And 20th century, it was USA. 21st century, it happens to be India. And that change, which this government is working on in terms of bringing these structural changes from Jan Dhan to LPG to focusing on direct benefits, doing away with the middlemen, and taking the benefits to the people who need it the most, and taking it away from the people who were undeservingly getting them. So the benefits should reach the people who need the welfare schemes, whereas the ones who are supposed to do their bit to improve the economy don't end up cheating the system and getting away with it. So blocking those roads which allow large-scale corruption and helping out the welfare mechanisms for the ones who have been deprived of it for several years. That is the policy. And because of all these changes, whether it's the lowest of the low in terms of economic strata, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, and when I entered, Mr. Desai was talking about gender. So irrespective of gender, you can reap the benefits of all these schemes from 12 rupees insurance to accidental insurance and life insurance to have a card, to have a credit card and a debit card, and also bank accounts. Can you imagine something as basic as bank account was non-existent for a very large population, and we talked about inclusive growth all these years, whereas inclusion really didn't happen on the ground. So having policies which are going to be small changes but are going to make a large difference in coming years and have already, I call it baby steps, the baby steps have already been taken, and we intend to make the larger change and take India to the place it deserves to get, and rest is the write-up. Thank you.
Almost finished that, but I think the meeting cannot be complete till we have had a brief question-answer session. What I propose is I will take 5 questions, first of all, and then you please say whom the question is directed to, and then we'll get the response. Yes, please identify yourself. One question, I'll take 4 more altogether, and then we'll have a response.
My name is Arvinda Singh Brara. I'm Chairman and Managing Director of Mantech Consultants. My question is to the panel, but specifically to Mr. Srinder Kumar. The problem which is probably faced by most of the people in India wanting to do business and work is the absence of a really enabling environment. The income tax really gets after you. I mean, it's okay. They should get after people who are dishonest or not, but they do get after people who are paying taxes and doing everything okay, just to show that they have to meet their target before 31st. So there are issues regarding improving the enabling environment in various government departments. And the second point is the attitude. If you go to US or UK or any place in a government office, they look at you as a citizen with a helpful attitude. Here, if you go, the guy looks at it as if I'm the boss here and you've got to kowtow to me and, be servile and all that. So we have to do things to change these two. It's not easy, but I'd like to know how you think it can be done.
Is there any other question? Yes, please. So we'll take all five together because there's no time. We have to find out. Yes.
So my name is Jagjit Singh Kocha. When Mr. Suresh Prabhu went, I just thought that this was a golden opportunity. He was talking about listening to the people and understand. And then when he left, I realized that hamare man ki baat hamare beech mein reh jayegi. Kab karenge hum? So it's good that you are here. My message, another message I want to give. We keep hearing man ki baat. Hame bhi mauka do man ki baat kehne ka. Ek aisa platform hona chahiye jahan par hum apni baat man ki baat bhi keh sakein. Directly, is to start with, sir, he was talking about income tax and in the enabling environment. I just want to rattle out a few facts which are so crucial, which will change the whole paradigm what we want to achieve. At this moment, as an entrepreneur with my 30 years of experience, I can tell you 80% of time of an entrepreneur goes towards fulfilling statutory responsibility. या तो कोई एक्साइज वाला बुला रहा है वैट वाला बुला रहा है डिस्पाइट ऑल योर पोर्टल्स एंड एवरीथिंग इवन इफ यू फाइल्ड एवरी इंफॉर्मेशन दे हैव रीजंस टू कॉल यू यस्टरडे ओनली आई वाज कॉल्ड बाय वन इनकम टैक्स ऑफिसर यू गिव मी दिस इंफॉर्मेशन दैट इंफॉर्मेशन एंड सेंड मी 1 lakh rupees ऑल्सो दिस इज हैपनिंग नाउ आई एम जस्ट टॉक अबाउट यस्टरडे सो वन वॉट कैन बी डन सो दैट देर इज नो इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट No excise department, and I can give you a solution on that. I am giving you a solution on that. You see, only on income tax, Modi Sahib has promised that black money will come back into the system, and I'm giving you a way how it can be brought back. This whole black money and white money is because of income tax. Isn't it? There's nothing else. It's only if you're paying income tax, it's white money. If you're not paying income tax, it's black money. And if I abolish income tax, statistics is, in India, only 3.5% of the total population is filing return. 3.5%. Out of that 3.5%, 80% are in the income group of 5 lakh to 10 lakh. They contribute only 20% of the tax. That means 80% of the tax is being collected from only 60 lakh people. Which means, just because of those 60 lakh people, we have a system which empowers somebody to raid anyone, to waste anyone's time. What is the solution of this? Suppose if I don't have an income tax, this whole system goes. If I charge only 0.5% as a transaction charge for every payment made, and if I abolish all the currency, and ask everyone to deposit money into the bank. There will be so much of liquidity in the bank, and the whole currency will go. Every payment through digital, what we are talking about, platforms, when we see this kind of a facilitation, when there's no income tax, you just chart in, and we have got a calculation. 10 times, you will collect 10 times the tax.
You'll get a response. You know, yeah.
I'll introduce myself, and my name is Shobhit Arya, and I'm the one who Ambassador Surinder Kumar was complimenting towards the end of his speech. So I thought I must get up and greet everyone. And the question would be directed to him, and I'm going to digress a little, although we'll stick to the agenda, and it is related to what Lord Desai also mentioned. You know, about his article earlier. Now, first I must thank him because when he said that with all the illustrious names on the cover, we had the gumption to maybe suggest several changes and maybe even say, he even said that maybe a couple of contributors wouldn't have been there. That only goes to say that we are not daunted with big names. So thank you for that. Now, in your article, you had mentioned that you spoke about reservation and you spoke about Patels, and this is the manuscript, this is not the final article. And then you went on to mention that, you know, why are Patels seeking reservation? How they have been wronged. And then you used a sentence, and I'm quoting that, and there's a sentence which we were very particular that we should delete, where you said that have their women been raped? This is your quote, not mine. And we insisted that we must delete that sentence. Now, is red flagging something like this going beyond the call of our duty? That's a question only to you.
Thank you. But that's all. Yes, last question.
I introduce myself. I'm Jabir Patel. I'm a president for India Arab Friendship Foundation organization, which have been approved by League of Arab States. I want to ask Mr. Surinder Kumar and Mr. Shashi Tharoorji regarding about MEA, Ministry of External Affairs, that both are the champions of the Ministry of External Affairs. They have served for the government of India. Yes, but former, his experience was there. So, Excellency, I want to tell you one thing regarding about the FDI. Our country is talking about FDI now. Our government is talking about FDI should come to India. But unfortunately, there's some problem in the external affairs when the people of Arab world or any other countries want to come and invest. If they want an opportunity to meet with the ministers or anybody in the external affairs, or through external affairs, it should come Vana division, all the division have been there. But they are not taking react on that request, and it is taking more than 6 months, 8 months, 9 months, and maybe there's ambassadors and the people are going to change. But you should always suggest about that this thing should be changed, because they can get an opportunity to meet the people of our country and the ministers, please.
Sir, I'm K. Mahesh. I'm a Special Secretary, Home and Delhi Government, and my question is to Mr. Manishankar Iyer. We have been talking about leapfrogging India, but in any of the chapter, do we find a mention about civil services reform? Professor Sarush, a great political philosopher who teaches in Harvard, talked about the efficiency and the productivity of the administration, of the governance is dependent on the non-represented political bodies like the bureaucracy, the auditing, the judiciary. And in India, if you talk about just economic reforms, but we are not talking about civil services reform.
Indian territories, whatever it is called. And I gave the inaugural lecture on civil service reform. Read that and all your answers are there. That will save Manishankar a lot of trouble.
I'll just briefly say that when I was at the External Affairs Ministry, our guidance to all our missions and our ambassadors was that they were, that economic diplomacy was a priority, that facilitating investment into India was part of their duties, that was as important to pay attention to these issues as to the chatter at the last diplomatic reception they attended and so on. This has been very much part of our approach, and I understand it's been reinforced by the present government as well. Now, whether it's being implemented in practice, you may have some specific case in mind that's troubling you. That I don't know. But then I'm sure Meenakshi Lekhi will speak effectively for the present government and why it's taking 8 months to respond to. 6 months to a year. Didn't happen in our time, I assure you.
Of course we need civil service reform, but much more than that, we need systemic reform. We need to leech the bureaucracy of the vast amount of power that they have and transfer it from the bureaucracy to the people themselves. This chariot of progress in 1991 was to run on two wheels. One was economic reform. The other was administrative reform. But while the wheel of economic reform has run fairly unimpeded for the last 25 years, almost nothing has happened with regard to the other wheel, which is depriving the civil service of the excessive powers it has and transferring them to the people for them to implement themselves. And in view of the disastrous failure of the civil service to function in a development atmosphere where they're very good with things like law and order, I think that the lack of symmetry between the running of these two wheels is what is responsible
for our growing very fast, but leaving our people exactly where they were.
I can only start. I mean, I agree with Mr. Iyer for a change, completely. And I think, as an MP, I understood that even MP lad, a letter coming from an MP, granting money for some project, does not take off something which has to be done in 3 weeks, 7 weeks time. Does not take off for 2.5 years, 2 years, 1.5 year. So this inbuilt inertia which exists in the civil services has to be removed. And at every step we are kind of failing, because in spite of the fact that, you know, you want something done at a smaller level, you need to speak to the secretary, you need to speak to the commissioners, which is not the way it should be. It should be automatic. Adarsh Gram Yojana, for example, was a process which was initiated. I was the first one without guidelines coming into force. I had already adopted a village, and I already started working. But end of the day, the way government functions, only government can do, and private individuals, no matter how much CSR you can get from NTPC or whichever place, it cannot be acquiesced to the ground until and unless civil service decides to deliver on the service. So reform in civil services and administration is a must. And some kind of accountability system. I think in Karnataka, they brought an act. I'm forgetting the name, if somebody can remind me. Where within certain days, for example, you need to have a death. No. Sakala. Sakala is the name. Sakala is the name. Through which there are days assigned. And if within that many days the job is not done, the civil servant is made responsible for that. Similarly, the bylaws amendment which happened today, interestingly, they have made a rule that within 20 days the permission has to be granted by all authorities. If within 20 days a permission is not granted, objections not made, 30th day it will be deemed to be approved. And in this particular case, if any objection has to be made, and if the declaration is false, if the like you were talking about how many people pay taxes, the question is how many people don't pay taxes end of the day. So if people don't pay taxes, should the amendment not be that people who have certain earning be brought into the tax net, because everybody needs to contribute towards nation building? And the suggestion cannot take off as of now until unless you have accountability system established, even 1% excise, which is being talked about on gold, something as luxurious and as expensive as gold, is not being adhered to. So you can't talk about these things until unless a few basic things happen. The foundation for including everyone on the detail is made. The third thing, I just want to give a figure, because people keep talking about FDI and things. So close to 3,800 crore has been brought in as the black money. 31 billion has come under FDI, which is highest, more than China and US. So things are happening. The shaping up obviously takes time, especially when you're dealing with a lot of resistance within the system to implement the projects, and bureaucracy does not want changes. They resist changes from anyone, and I'm taking side of the politicians, because I'm sure every political party wants to expedite and want to exert those changes, but somehow the work, the extra work which has to be undertaken, the system needs to be changed, attitudes need to be changed, is not acceptable. Everyone has to be on board. Ma'am, you have to take the chair's permission. I can't go on. Thank you very much.
Just now, the word reforms has been heard quite often in the last few speeches. We need political reform, economic reform, educational reform, administrative reforms. The politician was talking about it. Somebody from the audience got up to remind the politician, sir, what you need is chloroform. No. What you need is chloroform. The point I'm making is public cynicism about the political leadership across the board is growing very fast. Public cynicism about the system not working is going across the board. And cynicism is not a great base, provide great base for leapfrogging India.
Last word to you with a red card, that is fast.
Thanks a lot for coming here. If so many questions have been generated without your reading the book, I can imagine after you read book, you will buy a book, and I'm sure Soviet will be very happy for that. My friend, three of you ask questions to me, I'm the wrong person. I retired 8 years back. I have no role in this government. Meenakshi is the right person to convey your concerns and suggestions. Because the thing which you are relating, certainly I cannot really offer any. As for Soviet questions, I have always written what I believe in. I stand with each and every word there. It's black and white there in the public domain. And I stand, some will agree, some will not agree. So I live with my words. I have no regret, no apologies to offer for that. Thank you very much for coming. Please do buy some books. My publisher should be happy. He has been very angry with me. Thanks a lot.
Just one thing. I have read the book cover to cover. Mr. Kardik's article, the first line, emphasis is speed. Till there is speed, there'll be no progress. Thank you.
Yes. One line I had, my article is the last and the longest. Please do read it. And one first point is discipline. We don't have any discipline. We can't stand on the zebra line. We don't make a queue. Thank you.
Thank you. And please join for a cup of tea.
Please join for tea.